Hello. Today I'm going to tell you something about the research that Christoph Dobrounek, Jan Rotella and I did on the block cipher Pizza Mask 96. If you are interested, you can read more about it in our paper, which is titled Algebraic and Higher Order Differential Cryptanalysis of Pizza Mask 96, the title of this presentation. So what is Pizza Mask? Pizza Mask is a second round candidate for the NIST Lightweight Competition. It is designed by Gudasi, Shah, Koebel, Perrin, Rivin, Sasaki, and Tim. Pizza Mask consists of two schemes. So the first one is Pizza Mask 128 AEAD. It's an authenticated encryption scheme based on the block cipher Pizza Mask 128. It uses the OCB mode as a mode of operations. The other in the family is Pizza Mask 96 AEAD. It is based on the block cipher Pizza Mask 96, and it also uses the offset codebook mode. In our research, we focused on Pizza Mask 96, the block cipher. And what we managed to do was to design a key recovery attack on the full round Pizza Mask 96. The block cipher Pizza Mask 96 works on bit states of 3 rows of length 32. And the round function is designed as first we add the round key. The key of Pizza Mask 96 has 128 bits. The key schedule is linear. And after each step in the key schedule, you get a round key of 128 bits. You discard the last 32 and you add what remains you add to the Pizza Mask state. Then you do a subbytes layer where you apply a 3-bit SBox to each column. This SBox has degree 2 and its inverse also has degree 2, and that's important later. After that, you do the linear round, which is the mix rows, and it works by applying a circulant binary matrix to each row in the state. And it adds quite some diffusion to the scheme. So you do this 14 times because Pizza Mask 96 has 14 rounds. And after the last round, we do one extra round key. Our attack is based on higher order derivatives. I will repeat the definition and most important properties. We have a function, an element in the domain, and then we say the derivative of f to a, which we call delta a of f. It's a function that is defined by f of x plus a plus f of x. The interesting properties that it has is that you can repeat it as often as you'd like. So if a1 up until ak are linearly independent, you can reapply the derivative. And it's shown that it's the same as summing over all vectors in the space spanned by a1 up until ak of f of x plus v. We call this delta v of fx. If you have something that's not linearly independent, then this reapplied derivative will give 0. So if we investigate this multiple derivative, which is actually higher order derivative of f, then its degree is bounded by the degree of f minus the dimension of v. So if this dimension of v is large enough, then this will become at most 0, or maybe at most negative. And at most negative means that this is just the zero function. So if the degree of v is larger than the degree of f, then the derivative of f with respect to v is zero. So we can apply this to Pizza Mask, but before you can apply it to any function, you need to know what the degree of f is, because the dimension of v has to be at least the degree of f. So the degrees of the n-round versions of Pizza Mask 96 are upper bounded by the values in this table. The authors of the original BetaMask paper already included them, and they used the bounds by Bura, Kanto, and de Cagnère. So what we see here is that if we take a vector space or an affine space of dimension 94, then 10 rounds of BetaMask will give constant values. The inverse of BetaMask has the same property, and that's because the degrees of 10 rounds of BetaMask in the forward direction or 10 rounds of BetaMask in the backward direction are the same, because the only thing where it matters is in the non-linear layers, and that's only the subbytes layer. And as I mentioned before, the S-box has degree 2, but the inverse of the S-box also has degree 2. Okay, so we cannot get to all rounds, so we do something of a meet-in-the-middle attack. We can get 11.5 rounds for this distinguisher. So the 0.5 rounds means half round, which is actually the linear layers, so the add round key and the mix rows. Because they don't add to the degree, we can just include them in our function. We don't know exactly what this function looked like altogether, and if you want the algebraic normal form expression, that's not doable. But we know that applying this full vector space, we will get some constant values. If we choose this smart enough, then we can go to 11.5 rounds with a vector space of dimension 94. So that's what we're going to do. If we take U to be the space where the first column is zero, and everything else can be whatever, then this is a space of dimension 93. Then we take a vector space of dimension 1, which is zero in all positions except the first column. And the first column can be any vector except the zero vector. And then we add these two vector spaces to get a vector space of dimension 94. This is one dimensional. 93 dimensional sum is 94. And this is a vector space that helps us in getting constant values after 11 rounds of BetaMask. And that's because if you apply one round of BetaMask to this vector space V, then the result will also be an affine space. And if and then you have basically have a decrease of 2. So therefore you can get to 11 rounds. So now this left part, the solving equations part, I did not discuss yet. So that will be the next thing, because higher than 11.5 rounds with the distinguisher, it's not helping us break the system. So what we do, for each key bit, we put a variable. And then we run this together with corresponding plaintext through the system, and we get equations in the key bits, polynomial equations that we can try to solve. So how do you solve polynomial systems of equation? The easiest is to linearize the system. So we need to replace every monomial with a variable. And then we have a linear system. We can do Gaussian elimination to solve it. If we apply the full codebook, so for all possible ciphertexts, we compute the plaintext and we compute all the, or actually pre-compute all the equations that we can for a variable key, we get 448 equations. If we want to be able to solve the system, the number of variables, in our case would be number of monomials, should be at most 448. But unfortunately, we have way too many monomials at this point. So what can we do? We need to decrease the number of monomials, and for that we have some tricks. The first one, we try to reduce the monomials by looking more specifically at the S-box. So for instance, the first coordinate of the S-box is defined by the first coordinate times the last one plus the middle one. And if you expand these brackets and then reorder the terms, you see that you apply the sbox to P, and you add the sbox applied to K, and then you have these two mixed terms. So if you would write it out, you would see that the number of monomials in this upper equation would be 6. And in the lower one, if we say this will be a new variable and this will be a new variable, we will only have 4. So it's not a very big decrease, but it's still a decrease. And we can do this even further. So if we also apply the mix rows and the add-round key layer, then we get this equation. So we added the linear layer to these first parts, and we apply the linear layer to this last part, which consists of all mixed terms, and then we add the new round key. So now, if we take this part as a new variable and this part as new variables, we get equivalent keys and equivalent plain text, and we reduce the number of monomials by quite a big amount. And of course, since these are bijective, you can always go back to the result you needed afterwards, but it's still too many monomials. So at this point, there's only one thing you can do, or at least there's one thing that's trivial to do, maybe, is to do guess and determine. So what we do, we guess some of the round key bits and see if it works. So we guess all the bits in the first round key. So that's 96 bits that we guess that are either 0 or 1. And that reduces the number of monomials of the equation to 569. And that's quite close to the 448, but not yet close enough. So what we need to do, we guess 4 more bits, specific bits. They are called Kappa 1, Kappa 13, Kappa 25, and Kappa 26. But if you guess them, so that means you have to guess 100 bits in total, then we are left with 411 monomials. And for computation, it introduces a factor 2 to the 100. So it will cost some more time, but we can now solve the system with a Gaussian elimination. And adding all this together, we come to the complexities of our attack. So for 14 rounds, we have a time complexity of 2 to the 115 and a data complexity of 2 to the 96. So this is the full codebook. And this is less than the exhaustive key search on 128 bits. So therefore, technically or theoretically, it's a brick. And then we also have some reduced round. We did the computations of the amount of data you need and the amount of time it will cost. And this is all not very practical, or not practical at all, to get this amount of information or this amount of time. It's too much. But if we take 8 or 7 rounds, it will improve greatly. So this is actually, in time, this is doable. Getting this amount of information is still quite hard, but they are both below the birthday bound, so technically that's quite a relevant attack on these reduced round versions. And of course, there's always room for some future research. Some easy things to mention, well, they're not easy to research, but if you can do something, it will improve the attack, is to give better bounds on the degrees. I think that's quite hard, but if you reduce the upper bounds on the degrees, you immediately have an improved attack. But more importantly, you can try to attack the AEAD scheme, BJMask 96. We also tried that, and we got to 7 rounds with a huge time complexity and quite a big data complexity. But maybe someone else can do better. Or you can even, if you're feeling very lucky, try attacking the BJMask 128 AEAD scheme. to which this attack did not help us at all. So we don't have any results. Then there's nothing to that remains except for thanking you for your attention and hopefully seeing you at the online part of the presentation.